For an air breather, he's kind of handsome. What a compliment. Mazov slaps his hands at the water in front of him, as though he were banging his hands against the wall. Let me out, you monsters! It wasn't my idea. I didn't even want the damn talisman. As far as you can tell, there is nothing physically restraining him. You can reach right through the wall he's banging on. Try to understand the nature of Mazov's torment. He believes he's imprisoned in the oasis again, like he was long ago, but that alone should not be enough to anguish him like this. Finally, it dawns on you. His agony is not his physical imprisonment, but the fact that he was abandoned by his maker. Twice. He can't be forced free, but when he needs, what he wants most desperately, is help. He's looking around for a tool. Perhaps if you gave him something, then you could be the help that he needs. A shin? What's wrong? What's wrong with staying in your damn body for once, he says, though he doesn't seem to be responding to you. We could have escaped together, or you could have come back for me. I can't get out of here alone. He thinks, there's nothing in here. I need some kind of tool to get out of here. You're not trapped. Your prison is an illusion. Your prison's an illusion. No device can hold me. He looks around him, rubbing the back of his neck. If I had something to work with, that is. See if you can touch him. You put your hand right through the wall and place it on his shoulder. He doesn't seem to notice at all. Pull him out of his cage? With both hands, you grab him and pull him forward. When he reaches his imaginary wall, however, he meets some kind of resistance. His face smashes against the force that you can't see or feel. Doesn't seem to appreciate that. And why would he? That seems like it hurts. Leave me alone, he shouts, his mouth contorted, squished against nothing. Haven't you ever done enough? You let him go, and he floats back away from you. Again, his face smashes up against the invisible wall. Stop! Stop! You're crushing me, you bastards! You let him go, and he floats back away from you. Give him a shin. I should be getting red-tired for that. Mazov, here. Get yourself out with this. Is that gonna work? He looks at you, seeing you for the first time, then at the shin in your hand. His eyes light up. Ha! I knew you'd come back for me! And you smuggled a shaper key past those damn gibbers. Oh, he sees it as a shaper key. One shin we lost, I think we can spare it. He takes the shin from your hand, then he kneels down and works at some device you can't see. There's an audible click, the gibber around you swim away, and the haunted look drops from Mazov's natural eye. He looks at the shin in his hand. It was a shaper key. What? You. He narrows his eyes at you, then looks all around him, his Numenera eye flipping more quickly than you've ever seen it. We're not in the oasis. Of course. How could I be so stupid? How else could the resonance chamber have worked? Well, the guard's back. And now he's gone. What are you talking about? This is a psychic substrate, a kind of mental dimension that connects us to each other, the changing god and every last one of his children. Even with all my knowledge and abilities, there were things about the resonance chamber that were a mystery to me. This answers a lot of them. This is the thing that links us all, the plane of our minds. He looks at you again, eyes suddenly wide and frightened. He's here too, isn't he? He would have to be, if we were alive when the machine was activated. He grips you roughly by the shoulders. You have to stop him. He'll be after the core of this place so he can finish the job, so he can snuff us out and save his own damn self. I need your help. Come with me. Yeah. He looks like he's stealing his resolve. Yeah, I will. Let's... I gained something. He looks down at his feet suddenly. They're fading away. What the hell? It spreads up to his knees, then his legs. He's slowly disappearing. Damn it! Quick, take this! He shoves a device into your hand. Find him. Stop him. You have to. Soon the rest of his body fades, and then Mazov is gone. Oddly, you can still feel his voice in your mind. He might still be somewhere in the labyrinth, but you have no idea where. We got an all-burning aura. User is surrounded by a wreath of fire that deals 25... Wreath of fire that deals 25 energy damage to any characters in immediate range. This metal bracer seems to have been cobbled together from a number of unrelated pieces of tech. Various wires hang from the unit, and a panel of lights turns on with no apparent pattern. Occasionally, a spark shoots off from the device, more surprising than dangerous. A small band of metal on the back reads, "Property of Alaris," in faintly legible letters. When used, this bracer emits an aura of flame that surrounds its wearer. The flame burns anything that comes into contact with him or his weapons. However, due to its cobbled nature, the bracer also slightly burns its wearer while in use. It does? Do I get 25 energy damage too? Because I don't see any other effects. So he's gone. And we really shouldn't pick any more ciphers. That's the guard gibber. An air breather, huh? How exotic. Have you tried the Amrita?
All right.
Get out of my way. Never! Oh, Callistege is here. Well, let's...
All right.
I think Callistege would be here, too. What's this? This looks like some kind of underwater cafe. The water is warmer here, pleasantly so. Oving? Crackling heat washes over you, and you instinctively shield your eyes. When you move your hand, you are no longer in an underwater marketplace. You stand at the center of a village in flames. Tybir, a bruise blooming on his swollen cheek, tries to touch the back of the large man facing away from him. His hands go through the man, as if he weren't there. I like that with the tune and this effect here. Come with me, Arving, Tybir pleads. You don't need to stay here. We can leave this place behind us and never come back. He thinks he's dead. I know he died. Didn't he? Orving turns. Fresh blood spreads around the wounds in his wide chest, and his face is heavy with sorrow. You never learned, he says, shaking his head. It was never about the lying or the cheating. I would have forgiven all of that, fool that I was. His eyes rove over the burning huts that only the three of you can see. They needed us. They hired us to protect them, and you sold them out. I'm going to remain silent. Tybir says, no one died. I burned the village to scare them out. He protests weakly, staring at the ground. But the money was good, and I wanted to hurt you. Oh, Ty, Oving says, holding his wounds. You did. He is barely visible now, as insubstantial as the black smoke pouring through the air. You taught me to see things the way you did, that the world wasn't kind, and that it broke kind men. He lifts his eyes. But it was you that broke me. You taught me to hate my instincts, to call myself a fool for wanting to save people. But you weren't, Tybir says, clutching at Arving again. This time he nearly catches hold before his fingers sink through his lover's arm, like a man trying to hold on to fog. You taught me what a good man was. I didn't listen, but I heard. He lowers his head. That's why I went looking for you. I couldn't stand breaking your heart again. He thinks, I didn't know. I couldn't. Not before I met the cast-off girl. Orving reaches out and cups Tybir's face, holding it with hands growing solid. My heart was always stronger than you thought, he says softly, and he faces you, waiting. Can you stay for him, Orving? I'm not here now, he says gently, and no, I can't stay. With a sob, Tybir clutches at him, tangling his fingers in the larger man's clothes. Orving steps into Tybir's arms, smoke becoming flesh, holds him, and kisses the crown of his head. We were the same, Ty and me. We both wanted a kinder world, but he stopped believing, and I let him. Irving smiles at you. You didn't. You blink. It seems to last a very long time. You sense words being spoken, words that are not meant for you to hear. You sense a kiss lasting lifetimes. Aww. Okay. So he lost his ring and gained linked rings. When you open your eyes, Irving is gone, and you stand in the marketplace once more. Tybir rubs reddened eyes with a slow, shaking hand. Light glitters off the two rings there. Ready to go when you are, he says quietly. Are you going to be all right? Gold tired, small amount. Not at all, if I'm being honest, he says with a crooked smile. But the day isn't getting any shorter. Ready to go? Yeah, come with me. Let me look at these. Plus 3 health. Oh, breaking the bank. Plus 10% critical success chance on all tasks. Only usable by Tybir. Tybir wears these two plain tarnished rings on one finger. They seem to fit together as though one is much larger, even though one is much larger than the other. So, he has Orving's ring linked with his. It's actually kind of beautiful. Come with me. Gladly, lass.
Can't say I mind that.
Nothing to say?
Hell of a thing, your mind. Maybe you should have cleaned up a little before inviting people over.
I wasn't expecting guests. Well, I'll try not to peek in too many of your cupboards, so to speak. He thinks it's not the first time I've been so out of my depth. Still don't like it, though. Thumbing the corner of his eyes, he says, I have a feeling that if I kick a stone, you'll forget how to eat custard, or soil yourself. Neither option appeals. He rubs the back of his neck. Anyway, did you need something? You don't seem too bewildered by all of this. Well, no. I've spent a lot of time in people's heads, and not just in the traditional sense. Once went to a dance held in the mind of a dying friend. Not fun, mind you. A bit morbid. And the dance floor kept shrinking. He peers around. Her mind was smaller than this, too. Nothing against her, but she could have taken some decoration tips from you. This isn't strange for you at all? Oh, it's definitely strange, but not unusual. You know how it is. How are you holding up? Best as can be expected, he shrugs, unsmiling. I have some questions for you. Tempting, but no thank you. You know I love talking about myself, but this doesn't feel like the best of times. Alright, let's continue on. I'm with you. Huh. The water pulses with the shimmering of this dark veil, belying the falsity of this underwater fabrication. Okay, so I guess we're talking to Callistege next. Let me just check this thing again.
I'm ready.
It's just slightly past her. Nope, dormant. Greetings, Callistege. Callistege floats motionless, staring into the distance. Her echoes are likewise motionless, all of them arrayed in various poses like broken and discarded dolls, all of them staring at the same point in space. Nothing you say elicits any response. When you reach out to touch her, to shake her from her stupor, you see that her hands are clenched into fists and her body is trembling. As you touch her, you're moved in time and space to somewhere else. Images flash in front of your eyes, a cascade of other places and other times and other worlds that barely resolves from a blinding blur. You clutch at a single image, letting it bear you down into the endless chaos. Callistege lies on the bed, a skeleton draped in flesh. Each breath is labored, growing weaker. She raises one trembling hand and drops it onto her sternum. I'm in here. She searches your face for an answer, and finding none, begins to cry. Where are we? We're not sure. I'm here. Goldtide. At the sound of your voice, Callistege's hand inches toward you, only to fade into nothingness as a new reality takes hold. She thinks, help m- The room is silent save for the crackle of flames. Callistege sits in front of a fireplace, holding a letter written on transparent paper. With a perfectly steady hand, she touches it to the flame, fire consuming the words in one incendiary moment. She doesn't move as the flames lick at her sleeves, gradually taking hold and drawing plumes of acrid smoke from the folds of her dress. Come back to me, Callistege. Silvertide. She sees you, one long, haunted look bearing her away from you and back into the endless tide of other realities. A series of vases cover the mausoleum wall, each of them containing a few sprigs of greenery and a smattering of bedraggled wildflowers. It's never as much as you think it's going to be, Callistege says to a small wooden box at the base of the wall. She holds a golden flower, running the petals idly across her fingertips. Then she pulls the petals off, one by one, letting them fall to the rough stone floor, where she crushes them underfoot. Callistege, snap out of it. Callistege whirls to face you, but you lose sight of her face in the onslaught of other wens. You float in darkness, observing from a distance as Callistege manipulates controls in a small room surrounded by the void. As you drift away from her, another small room appears, identical to the first. Callistege stands in that room, too, her motions almost, but not quite, mirroring the first's. Another appears, and another, until the darkness is filled with identical boxes, connected by gossamer strands of energy. They become aware of each other at the same moment. Please, Callistege, I need you.
I'm ready to learn something new.
The illusion vanishes, and both you and Callistege are back in the labyrinth. As one, her echoes turn to regard you, some decidedly more unfriendly than others. Callistege herself is the last to look at you. You. So I got another silver tire, tiny man. I wonder if I had slapped her or shook her if we'd be going into other scenarios? And if this is the only one that would break her out? The one I chose last, right? Just now? You came for me. Callistege smiles at you, radiant, bashful, and genuine. So this is your labyrinth. The chamber worked then, I assume. She crosses her arms, looking around at the underwater marketplace, with greedy eyes. The substance of this psychic construct is positively charged. Whether it is your doing or simply the weight of the cast-off minds, I cannot say. But I can say, with some certainty, that this place is capable of forming a connection to the datasphere. If you concentrate, if you focus, I can help you guide you through opening that connection. How do you know this is the labyrinth? She gives you a condescending look. You should know better than that by now, child. The real question is, what is the labyrinth? She shakes her head. I doubt I know more than you on that score. Perhaps a metaphysical emanation of some kind? Would that we had time for study. She thinks, perhaps a psychic substrate. That would answer many questions, though it raises several of its own. What were those visions I had of you? Not me, dear. My sisters. She looks away. They are constantly crying for help, every moment of every day. As it stands, I can do nothing. I can only feel glad, in a very selfish way, that they are not me. She shakes her hair back from her face and meets your gaze. At least not yet. You can see why I must find a solution and why I sought one in the datasphere. Do you wish to explore the datasphere, though, or will you return to humanity? She loses her animation. Her sisters gather around her, and all their attention is focused on you. She touches her metal armband. Remove the attractor and return to humanity? Or ascend to become something ineffable? This is the moment of decision, isn't it? she whispers, and yet I find myself unable to answer the question. Whatever decision I make here will be irrevocable. Was she going to leave me if I choose number one? Let's come back to this later, maybe? I need her help. She sighs. In relief or frustration, you're not sure which. Yes, perhaps later. I don't want her to leave. Crap. Alright. I want to help her. But if she leaves for the data sphere and is just poof gone, and I can't get her back, I might be restoring a save just to warn you guys. I don't like to do that, but I do want to see what happens. I just don't know what it means. Let's revisit the idea of solving your situation. Ordinarily, I find a mercurial disposition charming, but at this juncture, it is merely tiresome. I will make my own decision, and I will make it now. You're right. She takes a deep breath. I must explore the data sphere. Our travels together have shown me that such possibilities await me there. Power and knowledge that I would be a fool to refuse. Of course, I can't do anything without your help. I'll help. What do I need to do? Just concentrate. Concentrate on opening the connection. Allow it to penetrate the labyrinth and allow it to reach your mind. I will aid you, as I have for so long. You close your eyes and concentrate. You know the connection must exist. If not through you, then through another cast-off. You feel something like a portal open within your mind, inside your imagination, a green and glowing aperture that flickers images and numbers. You can feel great minds moving on the other side, a vast ocean filled with mystery and wonder. A subsonic pulse thrums through it, and a bubble forms. This is not a dream. This is something being forced into your mind. Callistege's hand on your cheek is soft and cool. She stands corporeal in front of you, and also inside your dream mind, surveying this new construction. It's much as I imagined. If your sire's notes were correct, she taps out a sequence on a panel that you can't see. The bubble glows from within, a light cascading over her like a waterfall, like smoke, as her sisters enter the imaginary sphere. Through the sound and light, you see Callistege staring out at you.
Don't forget me.
Her hand disappears from her cheek. You open your eyes and she is no longer standing there, but she is still inside your imagination.
I think I'm ready to try something new.
Callistege, your corporeal companion, raises a hand to you, pressing it against the glass. She starts to dissolve, silver light pouring out from beneath her skin and shattering her face like a thousand points of light that fade away, drawn like moths into the open aperture. The humming ceases, the light gives out, and Callistege's handprint is left on the glass, slowly fading away. She is gone. What? No?
All right.
She's like completely gone. So she can't help me. Yeah, sorry guys. I'm gonna go back. I mean, I'll have to go through all this stuff again, but I'll just choose all the same conversation options again. And it'll be like take a matter of minutes because I won't have to read them out loud now. And I'll be back. Okay, we're back. I recognize some of this. You will not kill me, vice-like grip. Don't do this. Callistege is leaning toward a figure seated in a chair, her forehead resting on theirs. Don't shut me out again. She steps backward and slaps the figure, her body rocking with the force of it. The sound persists unnaturally, echoing in the corners of the room as though seeking an escape. The figure does not move. If that's... yeah. I might not have just remembered. Distant laughter mocks you as her eyes turn to yours. Dark and wounded, she shatters, the shards of her tearing open the relative safety of your words and exposing you both to the maelstrom beyond. She thinks, ha, you need... Callistege raises her head, bringing you into focus with difficulty. I have nothing. She opens her emaciated arms, and where the sunlight strikes her skin, she dissolves into flakes of ash that drift lazily upward in the golden air. Alright, let's try shaking her this time. I did everything else the same. Let me try something.
I'm ready to learn something new.
Yep. Okay. I got a red tie, though, for shaking her. Same. Now you know this is a labyrinth. What are those visions? Alright. Come with me. We have work to do.
Perfect.
As you wish, but know that I require an end to this chapter in my life. Her face is calm, and she stares unblinkingly at you. Okay, I'm not going to ask her this, because then she goes poof, right? How are you holding up? Well enough, given the circumstances, but let us keep moving. There are more battles to be fought than time we have left, I fear. She sighs. There's little enough to discuss on that topic at the best of times, which is clearly not... done. Let's keep going. Yes, let's. I hope I'm not really on a time limit here. Like, I can only go to, like, one or two of these three worlds? That would stink.
I'm ready.
So yeah, this is that portal that we heard about. It's just a wall of water. Yeah, I'm probably going to need her help. I mean, unless I take someone else, I'm thinking we'll find someone else. But I don't know their powers. I'm familiar with her. Look the same. Nothing's altered again. So we could sleep with Lady Ash, but that must make time go. You know? Remember with the murders in, Sega's Cliffs, in the underbelly. Every time we slept, time passed, and someone else got killed. Alright, let's level up. Yes, yes. Extra effort. Yeah, that. I don't know what she said. Tybir. Effort. And Callistege. Stat pools. I say intellect. Two intellect. She's good at that as it is, let's make her even better, right? Now, places. Do we have anything about the oasis? The Oasis of Emrod Jolios. That is. I don't see anything under O or the O. What's our journal say? The resonance chamber has trapped me and all the other castoffs in the labyrinth. The ghostly woman says the true resonance is in the deepest part of my mind. I have to get there before the specter if I want to decide the fate of the castoffs. Descend to the deepest fathoms. The Spectre is on his way to the residence. I have to get there first to stop him from subsuming all our minds into his. I helped Tybir resolve things with Orving as best as he could anyway. I freed Callistege from her personal torment involving her sisters. But we're not done with her. Alright, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode, when we'll go to the Crefton Fathom. That's a town. So I'll be very interested to see that. Thanks so much for watching, and enduring? Grow strong.